Hey guys, welcome to a very special episode of Doom. So today, we are going to be checking out the Snapmap mode for the first time. And I have a little map that I put together to play through and also to just show you some of the basics and also slightly more advanced features of Snapmap and its logic system. So, just to start things out, this is my map here. The way that Snapmap works, you can bring up basically this list of modules, and you just kind of snap them onto different connection points. Like here we have an extra one, we could just snap right on there. And it allows you to basically just expand and make custom maps based on these pretty cool templates. So I've thrown together just a rough little run through here, and what this is a little roguelike RPG style match. So it's 1 to 4 players, although it's mostly balanced for single player because that's just how I've been playing it so far. And as you can see, it's pretty complicated looking. It can be a little overwhelming. And just so you guys know, Snapmap, while it may be pretty limited, as a lot of people have noted, there is a lot of fun stuff you can do if you're willing to put in the time to put together some of these logic things. So today we're just going to be doing a rough overview of some of the basics, but if you guys enjoy this and comment about it, then maybe I will go ahead and put together some smaller individual videos explaining like how different modules that I've put together work. First things first, you spawn in here, and we pull away your weapon when you interact with this panel. So basically, when you use this panel, it gives you a weapon, which is the assault rifle, which is your starting gun. Over here, it will remove your weapon, and that will give you a shotgun. Then from there, you move in a little bit, or sorry, it takes away your shotgun, which is what everybody starts with. I wanted to start you with a pistol, but there is no pistol or chainsaw, unfortunately, available in the multiplayer at the moment. So then once you hit this switch and your weapon's been taken away, you'll go ahead and open up this door, and here is where you get to choose your class. So I have 3 basic classes set up: Assault, Heavy, and Support. Each of them has different sets of guns and a different equipment item, and I feel like they have fairly okay synergy just based on their loadouts. You can pay 200 bucks up front to get your first class upgrade, and then from there you can return here with, as long as you have at least $200 on you, and upgrade it again, so you can get a mod for your weapon and then a second weapon and then a mod for that weapon. So and here's the thing: when you die in this map, your money goes away forever. You get reset to $100. So you want to kind of go through a loop here I've created with some portals to prevent death until you get a couple loadout upgrades, because those do persist through death. Money is also something I had to create. So the way it works is basically money is a resource I created with an initial value of 0, and then these are less relevant since we control we have very precise controls on how they work. But your character does spawn in with 100, just gives you 100 when you come in. Then here you can see that every time you kill. So AI proxy is a piece of logic that basically means it will affect all enemies. This rule will apply to all of them. And it basically says, on me killing one of them, it adds $10. You can see here, the amount is here, 10, and the player resource is money to that player. And then over here, we have a rule that shows money on the HUD, which you'll see when we actually do the playthrough of the match. Over here, you've got a health refilling station. So when it's used, you spend money. If you successfully spend the money, it will give health to the player. And over here, we've got one that on used, spend money, and it'll give you ammo. Same deal. So these logic chains are pretty easy to get used to, easy to do once you get used to them, but the main thing to keep in mind is that you often have to choose sort of the noun before the verb. So you say money, and then you modify money as a spend command, and it pops out actually behind it in the chain, which can be a little hard to wrap your brain around. Lastly, we have non-persistent buffs here that I threw in. So for 1,000 bucks, you can get double damage, but it only lasts till death, and or double health. Then moving up here, we have a fairly complicated, fairly simple, actually, series of panels and switches that basically, when you use this panel, it disables several things. It enables our pressure plate here. It will unlock the door to let you through. Then when you step on the pressure plate, it'll lock the door behind you, disable the teleporter out of here, and trigger this encounter, which is a 1-minute survival event. Which is a pretty good way to just make some money, because once you finish it, you want to come down here and you can keep your money and return, or you can risk it all, as it were, and continue to try and get some better rewards, because you can actually progress to a second stage in this map. So usually you want to do a circuit or two of this, because when you run back, you can actually upgrade your loadout and, you know, push on to better and brighter places. From here, we want to push up these stairs, and you can see that we have some logic here that just kind of locks and unlocks these doors and triggers and disables different interactable things to keep the map from bugging out. But mostly you just come up these stairs, there's another health station, another ammo station, and then when you go through this box trigger here, which is like an invisible wall, basically, when you pass through it, it will trigger a mini boss event that I set up here, where you have to fight one group of enemies that I custom set up here, and then when they die, you fight a second tier of them. This guy should not be here. I thought I got rid of him. But then once it's finished, it will spawn a key. Once you pick up the key, it will trigger on top of the teleporter. Once you pick up the key, it will trigger the teleporter and send you back to your original spawn. And from the spawn, then you can go right instead of left in this first room and start progressing to the second stage. The second stage is very similar. It's just another upgrade room, but it has a checkpoint, so your player spawn gets disabled down there and re-enabled up here. You have more upgrade options in case you haven't finished your loadout or you just want to get the temporary buffs, and then we have just some more wave-based stuff, some more survival, and then a final encounter, which we will be checking out here shortly. So I hope you guys enjoyed the little map tour, really, really basic tutorial. There's one more thing I want to highlight here, because this is something it took me a very long time to figure out. So when you die in this, if there's an encounter running, enemies aren't automatically despawned, so they will still be hanging out in a room, which can be a real problem, because Snapmap, while you can work around it pretty easily, can only have 12 demons loaded in at a given time. You can create, like, trigger waves and stuff where they'll come in 12 at a time, but barring that, you cannot have a ton of demons present all at once, and so if they don't despawn, it can make it so like survival events become way easier, because only 3 enemies can spawn in this room if, say, there's 9 in another. So I was able to finally figure out through a lot of forum digging and experimentation that you can actually remove them through a series of overly complicated commands here. So I'm going to go over this in a little more detail. So the AI proxy, as we talked about, affects all AIs. This makes it so that when they're spawned, it will set their team to, via the team proxy, to team 4. So basically, you just do a blank AI proxy into a blank AI spawned into a set team, team 4, which is important. Well, it doesn't really matter which number you choose, but it's important that you assign them to a team, because then you're going to run a team proxy, which, then you're going to just throw this team proxy as the noun that this is modifying. Because down here, you're going to want them on team 4, because when the player proxy, which is, this affects all players, is killed or kills himself, you start iteration on this AI iterator. And an AI iterator goes through every single AI one at a time and applies a certain effect to them. I did not know about this for a little while. So once it starts its iteration on each AI, it will remove the demon, and then we say AI proxy again, because then it'll apply to all demons. So it will remove one demon repeatedly till all the AIs are gone. And the reason we wanted to assign them team 4 is because in case you're doing a map where you have multiple teams of demons that can fight each other, or you're assigning your you have maybe a unique demon that just sits there, and you don't want to always use wave events, that way it won't be removed if it's carrying something important, like, say, a key. That was an issue I ran into. That was the guy you saw me delete up here when I came up, the shield guy. He originally dropped the key, but I found that when I despawned all the AIs, he would despawn as well, which was less than ideal. So, without further ado, I hope you guys enjoyed the map tour, and I will be right back, and we will give this a shot. All right, so let's jump right in here. As you can see, the map is a lot more empty looking now that the triggers are all gone, so it's a much cleaner looking design than with all my stuff, you know, crammed into every corner. You start with 100 money, as you can see in the top left corner, or $100, so you can't actually buy anything on your first round. We're just going to be moving in here and trying to rack up a little bit of cash so that we can move on. Also, just so you guys know, I brought down the audio a little bit. I think it was still a bit too loud. It was overpowering me somewhat. Like I said, I've said before, it's kind of hard to judge exactly how loud it is just based off of the, you know, the headphone volume, because it's not really representative to how it sounds on speakers always. But anyways, back to the map. So as you see, you start out here with pretty easy thing. This is just a wave survival. Lasts 1 minute. It starts at level one waves just because we're starting you out real basic. However, you see I got low ammo here. You can buy ammo, as you guys saw. However, I get put in one alternative. If you do glory kills, then you can get ammo through that as well. Because some of the guns just have so little ammo, you cannot make it reasonably through these, like this survival mode, without having to basically melee a bunch of dudes all the time. So I added this in so that you could actually keep the combat moving without running out of ammo and being having to resort to punching 10 dudes in a row. So this adds a little bit more strategy. I was actually inspired by one of the in-game levels, or in-game rune trials, where you can kill guys and they drop only armor, but you only have one hit. So you got to be careful about losing health here, just because it does not come back anywhere except at these checkpoints. So I am going to risk it. I'm going to keep my money and go back. So it takes us back to the beginning. We just teleported in. And now we have 280 bucks. So we're going to go ahead and go for the assault loadout here. The assault loadout uses a combat shotgun, and the secondary is the plasma cannon. So hopefully we can do decently with this. Now we can kill these guys a lot more easily than with the dumb assault rifle. A fitting starting weapon, I think. And also we have the potential for mod upgrades and stuff as we move through here. I think we can actually get a lot more kills just using the combat shotgun, just because it's so much more efficient in terms of damage and also ammo usage. We don't have to do quite as many glory kills, although I do want to do them on occasion so we don't find ourselves in a spot where we're completely out of ammo and like surrounded by the engineers or something. Like those guys. Wow, we gotta be careful, we're taking a lot more damage here. So the way it works with the waves is that the longer that you survive, the more difficult of enemies will spawn, or rather, the more guys you kill during the wave survival, the more difficult of enemies will continually spawn. So that's why we're starting to see a lot more imps. I've never seen anything harder than an imp spawn in this 1 minute level one thing. However, later on we have a much more difficult survival that I haven't actually tried before. Okay, so this is our first death. The way this works is now our money resets to 100, but we get to keep our loadout. So we still have the shotgun, but you know, we are going to be having to redo this round here really quick. And we were doing pretty good too, what a shame. It's easy to get cocky when you're just blowing these dudes away, which is kind of why I like having this as the grinding area, because it's easy enough to do, but you have to, it actually requires that you pay some attention. I was trying to kind of go for an RPG roguelite sort of thing in this. And I think that if you're playing it multiplayer, it probably would be, you know, not necessarily a cakewalk, but pretty easy. But I'm looking into doing some more logic conditions that would make it so that, you know, the more players that are spawned in, the more difficult enemies get. We are not in a good spot here. Fight our way out of this corner, or get downed again. Hopefully we can actually make some progress into this map so that I can continue the tour of it, but we'll give this one more shot here. But yeah, this is definitely not the final version. This is just, it's finally at a working point. I think I will publish this version of the map. However, this is there will definitely be more iterations to come, since this is mostly a proof of concept for myself, so that I could see that you can do non-standard, game types that are not just like fight to the end of this corridor, because that was what my first impression of Snapmap was. It definitely has some issues, namely the fact that you only have this one tile set and the 12 demon limit, as well as some of the guns being gone, the fact that when you are doing the demon transformations, the only one available is Baron. But all that stuff aside, like, once you learn the logic, it's very powerful in terms of programming, and it's a lot of fun. Like, it's just very engaging. It's a really good, you know, baby's first game maker type thing, where you're not, you know, it runs on consoles quite well, and so, like, everybody can get into it. It's not just for, like, you know, people who use the Elder Scrolls construction system or something like that. But overall, you know, definitely needs improvement, but they have promised updates over time, and I've been enjoying what there is of it, at least so far. I think I might just do a separate video entirely talking about my thoughts on Snapmap and just kind of like ways they could improve it, things that I've enjoyed, things I've learned that a lot of people didn't think were possible, all that kind of stuff. So we made 560 bucks that time, which is enough to get two more assault upgrades. Now you may notice there's a slight delay on your weapon being changed. This is because the way that the logic works, there needs to be a minor delay, otherwise you have some issues where because of how it takes away a gun and puts a gun in and stuff, it can backfire and you'll pay, but then you won't actually get it. So, now we can roll through here. Since we have that 2 second delay, now we can roll through here with cool guns and not have to worry about weird money glitches and logic closers. I'm probably going to try and tune that down a bit, but as you saw, my logic in the first room is pretty cramped, and so I'm kind of putting it off a little bit just because it's going to be a fair amount of work trying to pick through it all and figure out what's what. But as you can see, though, the upgrades make a pretty big difference. So the... Oh, and I shouldn't forget that we have cool equipment. Since we're the assault, we have grenades. The heavies have ammo packs, and then the medics have... Or, sorry, the supports have the medic packs. But yeah, you can see we're just kind of tearing through them now that we actually have a mod and, like, a half-decent gun. I'm not going to really waste the Gauss cannon on such easy enemies here. But don't worry, in the next area we will certainly have ample excuse to use it. And actually we may here, because we needed to get this glory kill so we could get some more ammo. Alright. Need to deliberately not kill these guys outright. Come on, there we go. Get some more ammo going. Yeah, I'm hoping that the ammo and glory kill balancing adds in a little bit more tension, just because I know it can be a little repetitive to do an arena like this again and again. I tried to choose a fairly visually interesting one as well, just because some of them are laid out really poorly and look really bland. But there is technically one more upgrade. We can get the chargeable Gauss cannon upgrade. However, I'm pretty happy with this loadout, and I would like to move on from doing that same loop again and again. So we're going to really quick top off our health, because we can afford it, and we'll top off our ammo too. And I think you actually have to ammo up individually, but it's 25 for full ammo basically with any gun, so what are you going to do? Let's go ahead and use our Gauss cannon right away, because I don't want to die. And then we're going to try and just basically use the shotgun as an ammo, or as a backup source of ammo. We could stop one-shotting literally everything. Oh, dear. So this is a pretty difficult encounter that I tooled in here. And the main guy we got to worry about is this mancubus here. Him and these pinkies, because they charge you. Who's hitting me? God. We're going to try and, like, use the cover here to the best of our advantage, because there's a lot of dudes who are not great at cornering, but deal massive damage head-on. Sorry about the sirens. Again, the downsides of living so close to a police station. But what are you going to do? We are going to just make our way through here. And, oh god, we got to be a little bit more tactical, because again, there's no way to heal, and that can happen. Alright, let's try this one last time here, and then I may just jump forward a bit so we can show you some of the later stuff in the map. Hopefully you guys are enjoying this. I know it's a little bit different from what we normally do, but when I was learning about this, I noticed there was just a distinct lack of, like, decent quality, like, audio and video quality tutorial type things, and I thought this was a decent way to stick my foot in the water and see if you guys would be interested in me doing some more content based around, you know, custom map designs in this, and, you know, just tutorials on how to do some of the logic and, you know, that kind of stuff, because it is fun, but it's very time consuming. I'd say this map, since I was learning it as I went, this map probably took me about 10 hours to figure everything out and put it all together to the state that it's in now. But a lot of that involves me getting stuck on, like, the remove demons thing. I got really hung up on trying to get rid of guys without giving you a kill or despawning vital enemies or anything like that. And so I probably could have saved tons of time if I had a tutorial, hopefully like mine, that explained it. I think I am going to put up a video to pair with this one that is just a breakdown of a couple of the things that I got hung up on. Maybe the top five tips for people making Doom snap maps and getting started. Stuff that doesn't seem super obvious right off the bat. Okay, so we made it through the survival again, and I'm pretty confident we can make it through here this time. So again, you have to hit this switch every time because it deactivates the portal, because I want it to be a one-way decision. Alright, let's see what we got up here. We are going to heal up, and we are fine on ammo. Let's try and conserve our Gauss cannon a little better this time. We'll get 2 hits on the Hell Knight, but yeah, there we go. We want to actually try and get a glory kill. Oh wow, so F is not melee in multiplayer. Whoops. That is a problem I have a lot. I don't know what they were thinking when they made that decision. That's got to be the non-id guys, because that just seems like such a rookie... We're going to have a single player with completely different controls for the most part than the multiplayer. Like, that is not a good way to do things. Ooh, hello, Pinky. Alright, we need to try and eliminate these guys as efficiently as possible. I did it again. Oh, God. Keep on meleeing when I'm trying to trying, or sorry, keep on throwing grenades when I'm trying to just melee. All right, so middle mouse button melee, F, use equipment, or is it E? Ugh, multiplayer controls, you guys. All right, so I think that having, I still need to tool the difficulty a bit, and I think maybe I should remove one of these revenants. I think it's a little bit much with a mancubus too, considering that those rockets deal so much damage. Oof. Case in point. Wow, all right, we are cutting it close here. We're gonna have to do some cheesy bogusness. All right, the mancubus is a serious threat because it just takes one of his little fireballs to wipe us out here. But I want this to be difficult. I want it to be something that you have to run a bunch of times and actually get level up the gear. Ideally, you shouldn't be able to get all the way through it with an assault rifle. Though I may put in like a little Easter egg for people who can. Oh, we had him staggered, but then we missed out on finishing him. The mancubus actually regenerates if you don't get that finishing blow. Okay, here we go. Going for the kill. Yes. All right. First mini boss down. Let's go ahead and grab our newly spawned key that I told you about. And as we grab it, we will teleport out. And you can see we now have this power core. We can jump up here, place it in, and it opens up the gate to the next location. So I hope you guys enjoyed this. That's the first half of our map here and tutorial. And we will finish it up next time.